Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line.
The reports from the Republican convention in Dallas were to the effect that the conservatives had taken over the party. Frequently highlighted among agonized dissenters of this development was Congressman Jim Leach of Iowa, who was quoted as saying, "The question I'm asking myself is whether this convention is the death knell of moderate Republicans or the beginning of a swing back. Frankly, I don't know the answer." Well, as a matter of fact, neither do I, though I would be drawn to different characterizations. Mr. Leach has had a most distinguished career. He graduated from Princeton and did graduate work in the London School of Economics. He joined the staff of Congressman Donald Rumsfeld, entered the Foreign Service, learned Russian and German, served as a delegate to a number of international conferences with special emphasis on disarmament, went into private business, ran for Congress in 1976 from the 1st District of Iowa as a Republican, and has been reelected ever since. He was quoted in Dallas, "We're trying to keep as much irrationality as possible out of the platform. The country is a pragmatic, moderate nation, yet our party is becoming ideologically narrow." Our second guest, William A. Rusher, who was also at Dallas, would disagree. "Mr. Rusher, my colleague at National Review, where he has served as publisher for 25 years, is also a graduate of Princeton, and after that of the Harvard Law School. From there, he went to the practice of law in New York, then to Washington as assistant counsel to a Senate investigating committee, and then to National Review. He is the author of several books, but most recently and most pointedly, author of that book which bears directly on the question before the House today, namely, The Rise of the Right, published by Morrow Company. In that book, Mr. Rusher traces the fortunes of organized conservatism with special emphasis on the impact on that movement had by Senator Barry Goldwater, in whose nomination Mr. Rusher played a significant role. Mr. Rusher is frightened in considering the future of the GOP only by the possibility that the party will heed the warnings of Mr. Leach. So we should have a very good time during the next hour. The word is more widely used than it is understood, so I think I'll begin by asking Mr. Leach to tell us what is meant by a moderate position. For instance, what is the moderate position on school prayer?
Well, I'll answer that specifically in the second part, but let me say moderates in general today are not those that simply are in between two extremes. In my own view, one of the reasons that moderates are in such a weak position is that they've never articulated a philosophy as the conservatives have. We've never had a publication like the National Review with the same kind of quality and readership. But if you look at what people who identify themselves as not moderates are talking about, it's really mainstream Republican thought, dating back to Lincoln, opposition to slavery, Teddy Roosevelt, concern for the national park system, our first great environmentalist of this century, Wendell Willkie, who wrote a book called One World, in which he talked about responsible internationalism, Ike and his anti-interventionist foreign policy in some elements, as well as his basic pragmatism. And finally, we hearken much like Bill Rusher does to the Goldwater and Taft traditions of individual rights. And what we're concerned about today is a party that's moved beyond Barry Goldwater's individual rights conservatism, more to a conservatism of socialized values and lack of fiscal restraint, and in a sense a movement towards ideological purity rather than the themes of America, which are very pragmatic.
Well, I understand.
But let me come to your question, though, on school prayer, mm-hmm. because of all the great issues in American public life that are sudden and new but of great old standing, is the issue of prayer in school. And Frankly, maybe there is a moderate position, which is that it's reasonable for people to pray in silence, but that verbal prayer is something that holds a great, great concern for many people in terms of the potentiality of prejudice leaping into the public format, and that in a way public verbal prayer is the ultimate in state welfarism. It's a transfer from the family, from the individual responsibility for moral upbringing to the state.
Like a congressional chaplain?
Well, you make a good point that Congress does have a chaplain, and certainly all of us that know anything about American history knows that our Declaration of Independence was based upon a law beyond the law, and that if you ask for a fundamental distinction between communism and our sort of society, it's that we have the right of revolution based upon something superior to a common law system, whereas a Marxist environment is based upon a historical path of economic determinism. But having said that, I have great reservations about chaplains in schools performing services that during a school hour.
And can you point to the damage they did during the first 190 years of our republic?
Oh, I can't point to a great deal of damage, but I would say there's a great deal of danger in ending the distinction between church and state.
I've been struggling most of my adult lifetime against the notion that correct Republican conduct is defined by not wavering more than, say, 10 inches, to use a rectilinear measurement, away from the Democratic dogma of the day. You say that there have been no moderate Republican journals in America. It's probably true in respect of magazines. It's not at all true of newspapers. The Herald Tribune was sort of a Rockefellerite, Whitneyite journal here in America, and did its best, in my judgment and the opinion of Mr. Rusher, to emasculate the Republican Party, so much so that it finally ran out of steam. Every prominent Republican who classified himself as moderate in those days either expired or became a Democrat, John Lindsay, for instance, or Jacob Jacobs, Jack Davids, who was defeated. But let's ask for Mr. Rusher, who in his book traces, if you like, the fight against moderation and sees in it an adulterating agent, not something that stands in the way of ideological fundamentalism, but that stands in the way of coherence. Am I overdoing it here, Mr. Rusher?
Well, the appeal of conservatism can be one of two kinds. It can be an ideological appeal. It appeals to me in that way. I think it is a coherent system of thought. I think it is principled. I think it has, as Congressman Leach says, its articulations. At the same time, it seems to me that the case is getting pretty powerful that it's also just plain politically successful. It wasn't so long ago that Gerald Ford said to somebody, I forget who, it may have been Reagan, speaking of the conservatives, you're not a majority in the party, and you certainly are not a majority in the country. And his argument against Reagan was that Reagan couldn't win. But here came Mr. Reagan in 1980 and won, and the rumor is that he's going to win again. So that there begins to be added to the ideological case for conservatism a pragmatic case which at the same time and in precisely the same measure diminishes, it seems to me, the argument of the moderate Republicans or liberal Republicans that the only way we were ever going to win was by trimming closer to the Democratic liberal position.
Well, now, you weren't saying this was the only way we were going to win. You weren't arguing in Dallas, as I picked it up, the notion that we were heading towards defeat. You were arguing against the strategic uses of the Republican Party.
Yes, I did not mean to attribute that to their position in Dallas, but over the years, sure, through the 60s and the 70s.
Well, I think you have some fair observations, Bill, but I would stress that one of the problems with the definition of conservatism today and whether it's taking on some opportunistic elements, I mean, I hearken back, frankly, and maybe it's more defeatist to some of Barry Goldwater's principles. You know, it's no accident Barry Goldwater's against prayer in school. Mm-hmm. It's no accident.
No. Barry Goldwater's against
the constitutional amendment.
That's right. He's very different.
Yes, that is. Yeah. That is. And he's also against a constitutional amendment that would preclude the abortion option. But what I would stress is that if you look at the conservative movement today, there are some real questions that have to be asked, because there are some opposite positions being taken. Is it conservative to be interventionist or non-interventionist? Mm-hmm. Is it conservative to stress individual rights or socialized values? Is it conservative to be for tax cuts at all costs or for a balanced budget? And oddly enough, the conservative movement today is one that's moving in a direction that is using the advantages of an old-fashioned view of conservatism, but is putting forth some very non-historically conservative notions.
Well, the conservative—you're quite right. The conservative movement today is a pretty big thing and a pretty various thing,
sure.
And I think that's natural, by the way. When a movement gets large enough, when a party gets as big and sort of united as it was at Dallas for a movement, it begins to develop fissures and
sure.
differences of opinion within it, and I think that most of the differences in the Republican Party for the immediate future are going to be arguments within the conservative community that's now dominant within the party, and you've touched on some of them. I question whether or not a budget ought to be balanced first or taxes cut anyway is a classic example of that, and there are many others. But on the other hand, that is in a sense just the sheer exuberance of growth going on. This movement is developing ideas, and look at Newt Gingrich and all that he and Congress has contributed there, and just within the last couple of years, in terms of new thoughts and new formulations.
Well, I would agree with you that the conservative movement in America has been more idea generating than the moderates. That's one reason the moderates mm-hmm. have not done well, and they've also had far better candidates, particularly at the presidential level.
Oh, we've been lucky in Ronald Reagan. You'll never get me to deny that.
And Jack Kemp is a sterling candidate. I mean, first class. We all wish we could claim him. I just happen to differ a little bit on a few views. But I would stress that it's a little unfair that you look at a Republican convention and look at this as a discourse in conservatism. Then it's certainly a discourse in a political party called Republican, within which the conservative or self-defined conservatives are playing a more dominant role. But it's Republicanism that's coming back, in which we have a fine conservative leader.
I'm not sure that Republicanism is necessarily coming back. I think that remains to be seen. Incidentally, on the subject of Reagan as a popular personality, and he certainly is one, and that certainly has been of enormous strength to conservatism, I from time to time find liberals or moderates taking some consolation from that fact, and the thought being that, well, what they've really got is a very popular personal tiger here. I don't recall, and I go back to that day, I don't recall the liberals of the 1930s ever saying, let's face it, it isn't the New Deal that's popular, it's Franklin Roosevelt. And yet he was a charismatic leader. And in certain ways analogous to Reagan, I think. And they didn't ever modestly remind themselves that their views were not all that popular. You know.
But they did have one analogy that I think is very real, that not only did they have a popular leader, and as the Republicans do today, but the opposition to some degree abdicated in the 30s because of circumstances, the Great Depression. Today, in the last two elections, the Democratic Party has simply put forth unpersuasive candidates. And you know as well as I do, if we were talking about Walter Mondale leading the Republicans and Ronald Reagan the Democrats, the polls would be a little bit different today. And so there
you
is an element of leadership.
You just ruined my day. Good Lord.
The surrealism is beyond us. I suppose we could go back and listen to some of Ronald Reagan's speeches back when he was a member of the American Democratic Action.
Surely.
Apparently they use that as a smoker in some Democratic intellectual councils, a speech he gave when he was 35 years old, advocating God knows what. But let me probe this line on you. Arthur Schlesinger likes to say, the American voter likes conservative rhetoric and liberal policies. And I think it is true that people could say about the Reagan administration something which, by the way, has an interesting correspondence with the Thatcher administration. Mrs. Thatcher is spending 3.5 to 4% more of the British GNP on government spending than was spent when she took over the reins of office from James, what's his name? And by the same token, here we're spending 2.5 to 3% more of the GNP than we were when Ms. Clark went out of office. Now, there are all kinds of fine-tuning that we can do here, among that to mention that $100 billion a year, roughly speaking, was spent during the two big depression years of 62 and 63. But still, farm subsidies are way up. We're spending more greens on food stamps. It requires the work of a diligent ideological archivist, somebody like, say, Michael Harrington, to isolate those items in the welfarist agenda that Mr. Reagan has really damaged. He talked about ending the Department of Education, which flourishes, and so on down the line. Now, are you guided by this bifurcation that Professor Schlesinger points to? We had in the 19th century Tory rhetoric, Whig measures. Are we reenacting that great disillusionment or that great chimera?
I think there is something to what you said, Bill, although in politics, and I think you're going to see a little evidence of it this year, there's going to be an indication that the American people really want a conservative rhetoric president, but a Congress of a little different makeup. Beyond that, the interesting thing in going back to definitions of conservative is applied to this discussion. If one is sitting on the moon and starts listing all the conservative stands that are being taken, and then the stands that are being taken in opposition by the so-called moderates, with an abstract definition of conservatism, I think someone sitting on the moon might argue that my moderation position is more conservative than the so-called conservative position being espoused by some so-called conservatives. And I mean, let me mention, I mean, I would argue for a balanced budget. I'd argue for a non-interventionist foreign policy.
Let's take one at a time. You would argue for a balanced budget, so would I, so would he. But at what point would you balance it? We are all convinced that the moment you increase taxation, you're going to increase pari passu, federal spending. Exactly what happened in 1982.
Well, you
people were going to reduce by a ratio of 3-1 spending over against taxing. Very nearly the opposite happened. So what is it that is to persuade us immoderately to decline to examine the empirical data that have piled up? If you tax more, you're going to spend more. Now, I'd give you a balanced budget tomorrow if you'd guarantee, let's say, to reduce federal spending to 20% of the GNP.
Well, you and I may agree. I mean, I once, and I think it was probably illogical to the degree that it fits the Constitution, proposed maybe we ought to have a constitutional amendment saying 20% of the...
Is that immoderate?
No, I think it's more conservative than the president's position, and perhaps more conservative than...
It is his
than,
position. Well, he wants it.
Well, he wants it, but he doesn't act on it. And I would favor, for example, across-the-board spending restraint, including the military budget. And what you
Wait a minute. Why would you want to restrain the military budget if it's required for objective reasons or for prudent reasons? It's like restraining calories irrespective of the biological requirement to stay alive, isn't it?
Well, if you can tell me...
Well, I can't.
Well, no, let me answer my question.
Yeah.
Before you answer it. If you can tell me that the MX missile is needed, that a new generation of chemical weapons are needed, that
Wait a minute, it's one
then
time.
Maybe I'd go along with you. But
I'm not saying that MX is the difference between survival and not survival. I'm saying that four successive Secretaries of Defense, three of them Democrats, two presidents, one of them Democrats, said we needed it. The Democrats wanted twice as many as Reagan is willing to satisfy himself for. So it's hardly an immoderate proposal. On the contrary, it's the most moderate proposal. All of a sudden, Moynihan has discovered a cause militant in the MX missile. So he thinks it's going to destabilize. Well, what I'm saying is that all of these arguments can flourish, but to suggest that the development of a missile, which has been prescribed by people who are professionally concerned for our defense, is fanatical, asks us to beggar the notion that intelligent people are intelligently concerned about our defense. Is that correct?
I think you've put an argument in my head that I didn't express. What I would express to you is my view that three American administrations are wrong, mm-hmm. and that it is not crucial to the United States national security, and that perhaps a little greater emphasis on arms control and less in the arms race might be helpful.
How would you, could you tell me, how would you put more emphasis on arms control?
Well, I would start.
I think the congressman favors a nuclear freeze, do you
Yes,
know?
That's true, Bill.
Yes,
I do.
That's one way.
But I think it's
so you would not have favored deploying the Pershing, but you came out for 9 month delay.
Yes,
you
sir.
You said only if the Soviet Union made certain concessions, which they didn't make. I have your quote if you
surely.
If that would help.
And
you.
And I would stand behind that.
So therefore you were in favor of deployment?
No, I was not in favor of deployment at that time, but I certainly wouldn't preclude the option of deployment at an appropriate time.
May I ask how, since you favor a nuclear freeze, a mutual and verifiable freeze
yes,
on testing, production, and deployment, how precisely you would verify a production freeze? I ask because my understanding is there is no way it can be done, and not even Leslie Gell.
Otherwise, you wouldn't have.
Took it up with him precisely. Agreed.
It's interesting.
In other words, what I'm saying is the whole proposal.
I hope
of
you're
a
not losing Leslie Gelb as the only authority.
No,
there are other authorities
I'm,
on the subject,
perhaps
including
there are, but
former
I'm,
CIA directors.
I'm
who
suggesting
would
that, though, and let me at least make the point that I think that calling for that kind of a nuclear freeze is like calling for a perpetual motion machine. You're asking for something that can't be had.
Well, if you look at the arms control debate, for some reason, those of us that support a freeze are considered to be, gee, isn't that a little radical? The president supports reductions, and presumably, one believes he's sincere about his offer of reductions, and he assumes they can be verified, then why can't we assume that freezing at given levels can be verified? And isn't it easier to verify a freeze at given levels than it is reductions? Interestingly, in terms of numbers, the freeze is a far more readily verifiable instrument than reductions. Now, your point goes to the production issue,
yes.
Which I grant is very difficult to verify, but we would not abide by it unless we were given, obviously, on-site inspection and a series of other options.
You mean that? You would insist on on-site inspection?
For production, yes, I would.
Let me tell you, Ms. Leach, you're not going to get it.
Well,
the Soviet Union is not going to give you answer.
In addition to which,
never made anything clearer
how do you get
since
even,
Lenin
use,
was buried.
Well,
how do you
if,
use
if
even
that,
on-site
let's challenge
production.
This assumption, though. Mm-hmm. The Soviet Union has suggested that they are willing to accept on-site inspection for a comprehensive test ban. That has been largely overlooked in the American vocabulary.
An extremely modest amount of on-site inspector.
That is
I think
correct.
About two testers,
three
sensors.
And you know, if you look at the history of arms control and all the fear that surrounded it, there's probably never been a greater arms control mistake in the history of this country than John Kennedy's refusal to accept three and insisted and set an eight on-site inspections for a comprehensive test
where
ban
would you
in 63.
Where would you put eight on-site sensors to monitor production, may I ask?
No, I think production is a very different issue.
You bet it is.
You're darn right. I would agree.
Well, then how would you verify it, dear sir?
Well, I would, first of all, suggest that there are some types of things that massive violations can be indicated on. Inspection of perfect verification is probably impossible on the production score. But as William Colby, the former CIA director, has indicated, that there would certainly be the prospect of adequate verification of anything happening that would be of significant changing the balance of power within a treaty framework of a freeze dimension. And I think that's worthy of listening to. And what you're really putting yourself and asking the fundamental question is whether we're safer as a society to continue building up or whether you're safer as a society to try to put some restraints.
I don't understand President Reagan to favor continuing to build up. He is involved in a process to bring the Soviet Union to a realization, which is going to be very painful to them, that they simply cannot afford to continue the kind of an arms race in which they are now marginally ahead.
Well, that's one way of looking at it.
Let's not turn this into an argument about arms control, except to the extent that it illuminates the general question. I tell you what, let's do, Mr. Leach. Let's go back a little bit in the Republican Party, since Mr. Rush has written an interesting book on the subject. He maintains in this book, The Rise of the Right, that
the Republican Party was coming to a kind of breathless standstill. It had become etiolated. There was nothing sort of left there. And that the inertia of Roosevelt, Dewey, and so on and so forth, which was simply an imitation of the New Deal without any invigorating sense of differentiation, led to the flash loss of Goldwater, but not by any means to the elimination of the Goldwater movement. Is this correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes, the Goldwater year, 1964, was actually the growth year for conservatism. It laid the foundation for everything else. It gave us a party because it took control of the party. It gave us the means of communication because it created the mailing list, and it gave us ultimately the candidate Ronald Reagan, who then went on to governor and
president. But now, was it in any sense a political emancipation here? That is to say, were certain windows suddenly opened that permitted people to view a society going in a different direction from the direction in which we saw it as heading under a long two-generation succession of Democratic presidents and Republican fellow travelers?
I don't think, Bill, that we conservatives ought to take too much credit here. The credit we can take is that we devised an alternative in case anybody got around to wanting the alternative. But my secret conviction is that we could have yelled our heads off about the faults of liberalism. It was liberalism's own visible, demonstrable failure in and after the 1960s and through the 70s that convinced enough of the American people, I think, to change the voting pattern.
Well, that was one of our criticisms of liberalism. On the other hand, I don't think anyone here is wedded to the proposition, or is this correct? I sound like Nixon, or am I wrong? anybody here is wedded to the proposition.
Make this perfectly clear.
That a society automatically corrects its own mistakes. That's angelism, to which we don't subscribe. There's an awful lot that's going on, perpetually going on, places like Sweden and Norway, which is sort of stultifying of the human spirit.
Until the error becomes overwhelming. That's what happened in the case of liberalism.
Let me comment on this. I mean, first of all, there's an assumption that differentiation is always an important and good thing in American society, and sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. I have a great deal of identity with Dwight David Eisenhower. I think those were very good years in America, and he was a fine American president. And why one wants to reject Dwight David Eisenhower, I don't know.
That was the last stretch of time in which we might have contained the Soviet Union.
Let me go back at it another way.
Hungary was, we showed our tail there.
We showed excellent prudence. We had no capacity to deal with the Soviet Union back door.
We'd be a prudent.
Would you have let us into war in Hungary, Bill?
No, I would have avoided war.
I would think not.
And I would have avoided much of what concerns you now.
Well, let me go back again. I mean, we're talking here about liberalism and conservatism. Dwight David Eisenhower presided over an American society in which the government spent less than 20% of the GNP. Ronald Reagan presides over an American society where he's increased it from 22 to 24%. Who is the conservative? Ronald Reagan or Dwight David Eisenhower?
I don't think that merely presiding over a particular percentage of the GNP is the test. The point is that Reagan is worried about it and Eisenhower wasn't.
Besides, but you know that all 83% of all federal expenditures are committed and have been committed by legislative action that took place before.
But no president has pushed the discretionary spending as rapidly in peacetime as Ronald Reagan. Happens to be largely in the defense camp, which you would defend. But my point is, we are at least listening to the two of you, want to reject a very conservative, very pragmatic American president who served in a prudent way. Not only did he keep us out of Hungary, which was the right decision, he said no to the French. It's nonsense to fight a land war in 1954 in Vietnam. Took John Kennedy, the idiot, to say we could. And beyond that, in terms of basic recognition of world trends, he said to the British and the French, you know, it's nuts to go into Egypt.
Mr. Leach, so profound was Mr. Eisenhower's impact on American politics that in 1958 Democrats ran away with congressional elections. In 1960 a Democrat was elected. In 1964 he was reelected, and he mounted this fortress of horrors from which we are attempting to escape. Mr. Reagan, we began by admitting, is a meliorist president. One doesn't ask, are we better off than we were under Carter in the sense that we are spending
as little. We're asking, are we spending less than we would otherwise have spent? And the answer is, I think, yes, he is the first person to have reduced the rate of growth of government. This is the only thing you can give to him. But to suggest that Mr. Eisenhower, who put most people to sleep, and who left Republicans absolutely without any kind of ignition.
He left us with a poor presidential candidate, which is one of the tragedies of the Eisenhower.
I don't see how you can say that about Nixon. Nixon's lost fewer elections than almost anyone I can think of. He's lost 2 out of 16. That's a pretty good record. And for somebody to have won as triumphantly as he did last time he ran, 1972, it's rough to say that he is a poor presidential candidate. I think, in a sense, he's a better presidential candidate than he ought to be.
Well, in terms of candidacy, you're right. In terms of character practice, differently. But I would
suggest
that a better candidate in 1960 would easily have won.
What's that?
Would you disagree that a better candidate in 1960 would have won?
Such as who?
Well, such as Bill Scranton, who would have been a fine candidate.
I do not think Bill Scranton would have won in 1960.
Norman Mailer says that it was his essay in The Village Voice that tilted the national election in favor of Kennedy. The fact is, Kennedy won so narrowly that you can say that the weather in New Hampshire might have been responsible for his victory or whatever. It was that chancy. What I'm simply saying is that in Mr. Rush's book, I think he correctly traces a creeping lifelessness in the Republican Party, and that was the result of any lack of definition. We had really lost, for instance, our presumption against federal action. I don't see Mr. Reagan doing anything, for instance, about the growth of the National Council for the Arts. All of a sudden, it becomes Washington's responsibility to subsidize opera. God knows.
I'm more
in favor of opera than I'm in favor of Washington. But that I don't think that people ought to be taxed. There's nothing here that has clearly been arrested. What has been arrested is the aimlessness of our rhetoric. And that's why I'm sorry to see you come up again with terms like moderate, which is supposed to be an angel word, over against fundamentalist or narrow or orthodox.
Well, I accept your criticism about aimlessness of rhetoric in the moderate camp, and that's one of the reasons that I've spent a good deal of time in the last year trying to put a philosophical base to moderation, and I would argue that the philosophical base that we're now defining very precisely has a coherency, a consistency, and a persuasiveness that is very profound. And that in terms of the conservative movement, surprisingly with size, it's becoming rather flabby. And it's one thing to say that within the conservative movement that there are tensions between balance of budget and tax cut at all costs, between interventionism and non-interventionism. But these are oppositions that are rather extraordinary. And one of the things that's happened, and frankly to the great credit of the Republican Party, is that whether one agrees or disagrees with all the ideas being expressed, we are the party of ideas, thanks to Newt Gingrich, Jack Kemp, most of all Ronald Reagan, and others. And the Democratic Party is by definition, almost outside the battleground because they become a party of constituencies.
I never get tired of quoting H.L. Mencken's remark about the Democratic Party in 1924 as consisting of two gangs of natural enemies in a precarious state of symbiosis. And it's true, the Northern Party machines, the ethnic groups, and the Southern barons, the solid South, the old bigots, Rankin and the rest. If those two could coexist in a party, then Alan Greenspan and Jack Kemp can manage it in the Republican Party, it seems to me, however much they may disagree on the subject of whether or not we ought to cut taxes some more. Let me ask you, though. You said you favored, as I understand it, cutting expenses across the board, including defense.
Or at least holding them even.
How about entitlements?
I think that we're going to have to face some very real across-the-board spending restraint. It might be based upon, in some areas, a cost-of-living adjustment, such as in Social Security and perhaps in defense, and other areas more across the board. But unless
moderate
we do something
Republicans
across
favor
the board,
cutting the big entitlement programs,
I think you'll find a real willingness for across-the-board restraint and a much greater discipline frankly, in the moderate Republican camp than either the liberal Democrats and to some degree perhaps
the
conservative Republicans.
Where do they stand on farm subsidies?
Some of us are concerned about the size of the farm program, but I would say that the farm program today is one which, by the way, under President Reagan has grown fourfold in 3 years. But it only partially compensates for a fiscal and monetary policy that is bedeviling the Midwest, because it's pro-import and anti-export, and we from states like my own of Iowa are being really hurt very hard by this mix of monetary and fiscal policy. I personally would favor a much more modest farm program in return for a balanced federal budget.
In return for it? I think you
that's
might
right.
be able to get both, huh?
Well, it would be a reasonable trade-off.
If,
far
if,
better
if
for
you'd
the
like
farmer.
To work with us on that combination, maybe we can do business.
Sure.
Well, now, wait a minute. the interest rates, as we know, have been cut in half under Reagan.
Although real interest rates have grown to unprecedented levels since 1913.
Yes, I know that. But the point is that if you want to borrow money, you pay half as much now as you did 4 years ago. Now, isn't that a net benefaction to anybody who has to worry and lives part of the year at least on credit?
Well, it is not, because the major point is what is the difference between inflation and the borrowing cost. And for the first time since 1913, it's at double-digit levels. That is the extraordinary fact, and it's why in the Farm Bill, which is a borrowing-intensive part of American society, we have the first major industrial sector facing actual deflation. Land values have gone down 25% to 50% throughout the Farm Bill. Equipment values by perhaps a little higher percentage than that. Nowhere else in American society has deflation been seen in 30 years, and it's very wrenching, particularly when it stands alone. And what the Farm Bill wants is interest rates to be as a reflector of the basic across-the-board inflation rate back to historical norms, 3 or 4 percentage point difference, not the 10% to 15% which we've seen in recent years.
The trouble with those static analyses, Mr. Leach, is that it argues, for instance, for a law that also would limit any progress in technological invention. If you're going to say
it would encourage it.
Excuse me?
It would encourage it.
No,
it would produce more private sector borrowing for private, unless you think that the government's a better inventive device in the private sector.
No, I'm saying this, that if you were to say to a farmer, I'm going to limit you to the production of, say, 500 bushels of corn per year, that would stultify him, surely, much more than to permit him to cope with variable rates of interest. But philosophically, they are conjoined, aren't they? If you want to say to him, we're going to limit interest to a static figure of 3.5%. What's going to prevent a glut?
Oh well, I'm not saying that you can do that by arbitrary action. What you can do it by is restraining the borrowing needs of the federal government. That's what causes the interest to come back in relation
to
inflation.
But nobody in the history of the world has yet to prove that the government nobody has yet to establish that current interest rates are the result of a paucity of credited reserves. There's almost $1 trillion of insurance money that has piled up, which is available to the government without any noticeable rise in rates.
Well, if you're saying that supply and demand don't work, I'd be amazed.
No, what I'm saying is this, that a lot of lenders are still afraid of inflation. Well, one way to solve that, obviously, would be for Congress.
Reduce the deficit?
Well, I'll tell you a simpler way to do it. Another way to do it would be to have a guaranteed purchasing power bond. A few people in Congress would say, look, buy our five-year paper, and we'll guarantee you that you can turn your coupon in for 3.5% compounded per year, and it will reflect the diminution in the value of the dollar. That would be a way, absolutely and for all time, to eliminate the question, how much of that excess is due to fear of inflation, how much is it due to a scarcity of funds. But it seems to me that the laws of supply and demand are being tested by what a lot of people think is a synthetic scarcity of funds. It's very hard to understand why short-term paper is commanding the kind of premium that it is, 10.5%, 11%. But and this is not an answer to the farm problem. But it raises certain questions as to how, on the one hand, to deal with the incredible technological proficiency of the Midwestern farmer, on the one hand, and on, on the other hand, to make it possible for them to compete reasonably for credit. Have you any solution to it?
Well,
do you really believe that a balanced budget would hugely ease the...
A balanced budget would have two effects that are both significant. One, it takes the government out of the credit market, and no one would deny it's playing a substantial role today. But secondly, and perhaps as importantly, because you would discount the import of that, is that without question, the large deficits are attracting foreign capital into this country in excess, or at least to match the disadvantage we have in trade terms. And so by running these steep deficits, what we're doing is we're making an arbitrarily overvalued dollar. No sector of American society is more hurt by a high-priced dollar than the farm economy, because unlike the making of widgets, at least in grain, the price of grain is set abroad rather than in this country. And so what happens when you have a high-priced dollar, let's say it's 25% overvalued, which some, well, let's say the Institute for International Economics now assesses, that simply implies a farmer gets 25% less for his soybeans and less for his corn. If he got 25% more, the need for farm programs would precipitously decline. And so it's the macroeconomics that matter more to the farmer than the microeconomic program.
Okay, well, you take the macroeconomics. 20% of the American people are employed by farmers. That is to say, they buy 20% of what we produced. Now, if they stopped buying what we produced, that 20% would become a part of a common overhead, and that common overhead would have to be shared by people who live in Iowa and people who don't live in Iowa. So there is a sense in which everyone is a beneficiary of any sale abroad or vice versa.
Couldn't agree more. And these programs that we're now running are the most anti-foreign trade programs any federal government has ever run. I mean, what we are doing is devastating the competitive capacity of Americans to produce for world markets, and instead are running a pro-import, anti-export of fiscal and monetary policies, all under the name of conservatism.
Well, now, wait a minute. If in fact, we are selling, well, we are importing more than we are,
that's right,
are selling, you have a situation, do you not, in which dollars accumulate outside the United States?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's going to happen to those dollars?
Well, some are going to come
claims,
back here.
They are claims on future American production.
Sure. There.
Therefore, they will employ Americans. Meanwhile, you've conferred a huge benefit to the extent that someone has bought at a lower price than he can otherwise buy. If a housewife goes and buys a refrigerator at $1,000 in place of one she could get domestic for $1,200, she is $200 better off.
Well, what you
may I suggest that as in the case of defense, we are getting a little bit deep into the problems of one particular aspect of the economy here. Mr. Buckley has the agenda and knows where he wants to go, but
I want to go to 1988.
I was about to say, I'm dying to know who the moderates are for in 1988.
Oh. I think you'll find that moderates are going to be divided, and that just as the conservatives are going to be. I think you're going to have about a dozen candidates, from Jack Kemp and Jesse Helms on the right to probably on the left, perhaps Lowell Weicker, perhaps Bob Packwood, conceivably if he's elected, and I hope he is, Senator Richardson. In the center you have Dole and maybe two Doles, and you've got George Bush conceivably Pete DuPont. I think moderates will find anyone from the center to the left enthusiastically acceptable, and probably about anyone on the right acceptable to support in the final measure. My own view, by the way, is it's going to become very quickly a race between Jack Kemp and George Bush, and it'll be very close, and I would assume that most moderates would line up behind George Bush.
And
if not at the very beginning, certainly partway through.
Now, let me ask you this, Ms. Leach. Do you think that voters are going to be attracted to them on the basis of the images that they cast, or on the basis of the differences in the positions that they articulate?
I think that you'll see attraction based on, for institutional reasons, who is the more experienced who's the better orator, and some issue differentiations. George Bush is not a great record of espousing terribly moderate or liberal republicanism. By the same token, the one aspect of Bush's background that appeals to many of us that are moderate is that he is a very pragmatic, backgrounded person and has some concern about some of the ideological tendencies and has no great commitments in terms of people to some of the new right groups in American society. And so many of us would be confident of the types of appointments he would make to office and would be less confident of some of the appointments that some other candidates
might I interrupt here to make a taxonomic point?
Yes.
Because it confuses an awful lot of people, I find, in going around the country. Conservatism is very powerful in the Republican Party today, but there is increasingly a tendency, in the press at any rate, to talk about conservatism as if it were only the new right, and as if the new right consisted of Richard Viguerie, Howard Phillips, and Terry Dolan. Now, I know those three gentlemen, and I respect their sincerity and their earnestness and all the rest of it, but that's not what the Republican Party or the conservative movement is all about in this country.
That's
and
what
I think
it's
anybody.
About,
no,
though,
no, it, that, that is. That
we've
is,
moved away
I'm
from
sorry
Bill
to
Rusher
see,
and Bill Buckley
I'm sorry
into this
to
new
see
breed
you,
of anti intellectual.
Now you see, that's what I mean by the uses of rhetoric. You see, these boys don't want to discuss the opposition, they want to discuss Viguerie, Phillips, and Dolan,
right.
You see. And well, they're out there. And by the way, the Washington Post feels exactly the way you do on that, among other things.
Is your attribution of anti-intellectualism to Howard Phillips because he went to Harvard and you went to Princeton?
No, what I'm really driving at is that the new forces that are making a difference in American society are using some tactics that are less than seemly. I don't know how many people have gotten letters, fundraising appeals that are really divide this country. I mean, they tear apart the ethic of tolerance that holds people together in a free democratic system. And much of this money is raised for fundraising purposes, not to advance the causes espoused. These groups don't put much money out.
I don't object to your criticizing those people at all. I object to your calling the people you criticize the conservative movement. That's my problem.
Yeah, Mrs.
Well, they're more powerful than you and Bill are.
No, they are.
20 years ago, it was
without,
a reverse.
Without claiming any great power, I don't think that Vice President Bush himself described Viguerie as all hat and no cattle, didn't he, down in Dallas? I thought that was a pretty good description. Look, the Washington Post discovered about 3 years ago that they could go out to Richard Viguerie any day they wanted, and since they're running so many criticisms, liberal criticisms of Reagan, they wanted to be balanced and run a conservative criticism of Reagan, and so they could always get one from Richard Viguerie. He, in turn, discovered he could always get on page one of the Washington Post by performing according to style, and he's gone out there and done it, and that's all right for him. But let's not call that the conservative movement. There is a very good chance that all three of them will be out of the Republican Party altogether of their own choice by 1988.
Well, who says they ever came in? Richard Viguerie has never been a registered Republican, either as Terry Dolan. I don't think Howard Phillips ran for the Senate as a Democrat. Well, I mean, my gosh, we have non-Republicans trying to take over
Richard
our
Schweiker
party.
At one point.
And when they invite moderates and liberal Republican senators, as Terry Dolan did, to leave our party, I mean, that's nonsense.
Well, as I said, I think the chances are very good that they may console you by going one of these days. And you'll be surprised how many conservatives there will still be left in the Republican Party.
Well,
don't think that if they leave...
I don't think they have as great a following as
that
I suspect.
If they leave, your problems will be over. I assure you, Congressman, they're just beginning.
I feel very comfortable with the old-fashioned Bill Buckley conservative.
They look
very
good by comparison.
They sure do. And very uncomfortable with the Viguerie, new breed of conservative, who isn't even a Republican.
These are stylistic differences. Listen, we need more Republicans and more people in the party, whether they've changed their registration or not. That's another thing I object to about the moderates. You know, Mark Shields, the commentator, made in a program I was with him at Dallas a very interesting point, which I fully credit him. I've been using the terminology economic conservatives and social conservatives, highly political science stuff. He calls them, in party terms, natural-born Republicans and naturalized Republicans. And he says he's absolutely right. The Republican Party has got to have not just natural-born budget-balancing Republicans, economic conservatives. It has to have a lot of naturalized Republicans, people who started out as Democrats and independents and who have been trending Republican in this or that election and then going back occasionally or the other way.
Yeah, everyone goes back to alcohol.
Avec pardon?
As one goes back to alcohol.
As one goes back to alcohol, fall has a lost weekend. Now, the point is that we need, it seems to me, a party which is going to reach out to Democrats, but not to the person that might most get appealed to by Lowell Weicker, but to the person who has been a Democrat and a conservative Democrat by and large.
Let me suggest that I accept that, although I would also say that if you have to reach out by using some opportunistic issues that offend traditional Republicans and traditional conservatives, you're going to find just as you attract, you also repel. The great irony of 1984, and perhaps the greatest one, a Democratic presidential candidate almost won the nomination by attracting the so-called yuppie vote. Well, these yuppies are young, upwardly mobile professionals. They're the Republican base and the Republican future. And he had held his hand out to them because he was sympathetic to environmental issues, on arms control issues, and basically on the social, in opposition to the social issues
so
of the new Republicans.
Is that position. Well, your point
and
is
when the, and when that happens, the nature of a political party changes. And again, that's why I hearken back to Barry Goldwater,
you're going to
who
have
was more principled and less opportunistic.
If you will read my book, you will discover that Barry Goldwater is much more an economic conservative, the old natural-born Republican type, than he is a social conservative.
And but you're going. Don't you forget, Lowell Weicker attracts Democratic votes too, of a little different nature, but a whale of a lot.
Hard to believe. But
Connecticut's
possibly
a Democratic state. If you look at most of their legislative
and
offices.
He's a Democrat.
Oh, come on.
But you're really asking almost aesthetic questions here, because I don't like vulgarian rhetoric at any level, but I certainly reject the notion that it is distinctive to the right. I mean, I listen to any speech by Teddy Kennedy, and I'm not only prepared to close the door on the Democratic Party, but on democracy. I mean, the very notion that people stand up and listen to this without driving them out of town with wet rags is offensive to any Platonist attachment to democracy. But by the same token, the John Birch Society makes noises of that kind. Norman Lear, the most shimmering apocalyptic letter I have ever seen was signed by Norman Lear. And Norman Lear gave us Archie Bunker. That's his idea of how conservatives talk in Queens, whence Ms. Ferraro rose out of the loins of. So that if you're simply talking about what it is that tends to excite the attention of the mass of the American people, everybody has a lot to deplore. But I think it odd that that Richard Viguerie, who's, for my money, a highly intelligent, highly moral person, excitable, should be singled out for this kind of attention when there's so many of those other people. Even the ACLU, they give you the impression that if you don't go out and buy Fannie Hill tomorrow, they'll all be burned by the day after tomorrow. So that's just part of the metabolism.
Well, if I may suggest,
there
is a tendency in all of us to feel much more comfortable with our rhetoric and our immediate
set of friends and ideas. I disagree.
Well, let me finish
the point. I churn more when our types say things wrong than when their types do.
No, but I'm not saying when they're saying them right. Congressman Leach feels much better off with the average economic conservative, natural-born Republican than he will ever feel with people who maybe aren't even in the party today but might vote for us this year and are a little bit, have concerns that aren't deeply felt in his particular neck of the woods. But you're going to have to understand, and I'm surprised to hear this coming out of my mouth because I've had it tossed at me an awful lot longer than I've been tossing it, but you're going to have to get a majority, Congressman.
Well, I concur with part of what you're saying, but let me say there are two ways you attack the people that aren't the natural-born Republican. You can appeal to their lowest or you can appeal to their highest. And my point is that there are ways that moderate Republicans make tremendous appeals to natural-born Democrats. Lowell is a distinguished Republican United States Senator for whom I have respect.
How do you measure distinguished? By his appeal to Democrats?
Well, in the House, we choose our words carefully when we refer to the other body.
No, you don't.
But distinguished is a routine term, isn't it? Let me stress, I mean,
many moderate Republicans gain Democratic votes for a very different reason than other Republicans gain Democratic votes. Mm-hmm. You are right that a natural-born Republican is in the minority. and you have to naturalize, but you don't have to naturalize by using only one technique.
No, but
we are deeply offended by the technique currently being used.
Well,
not if it's wrong. I mean, you know, the analogy to sports.
Put it this way.
Is winning everything.
Put up with a certain amount of annoyance on your part as long as the Republican Party under conservative management can continue to win, which is what it's about to do.
Yeah, and Lowell Weicker, as recently as a year ago, said that he would not back Reagan for re-election because he was insufficient in his qualities as leader. 3 years earlier, he refused to back George Bush for election. So you're really talking about a maverick.
As someone that has backed both Ronald Reagan and George Bush,
I mean,
I don't identify with either of those two positions.
Yeah, no, I don't. I'm not saying you're the eccentric. I'm saying it's only eccentric of you to back an eccentric as a paradigm of a Republican statesman. But since we have only a minute to go, let me ask you this, Mr. Leach. Would you prophesy that if Mr. Reagan does, in fact, win an emphatic victory this time around, there will be a slight consolidation of political values in the direction that he's been beckoning?
I think there will be a short-term consolidation that I hope becomes long-term, but a lot will depend upon the economy in the next 2 years, whether you're going to get a reaction that will question deeply some of the economic directions we're going in.
As Mr. Burke said, there are no permanent victories, even as there are no permanent defeats. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Congressman Jim Leach of Iowa. Thank you very much, Mr. Rusher, author of The Rise on the Right. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, of Senior Citizen in Port Washington.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, Dow Chemical Company, the Mobil Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Atlantic Richfield, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250.